assurance allows me to love the Lord my God with everything that I am.
Yes, sir.
To put him first and not anything else. Amen?
All right,
therefore, as the elect of God, holy and beloved, put on, he's saying, get dressed in tender mercies, kindness, humility, meekness, long-suffering, bearing with one another.
It's really not hard to follow Christ because he will lead you where you need to go.
God we serve is high and holy. The God we serve is majestic and mighty. The God we serve is great and glorious. He is wise and true. He is a strong high tower in whom we can have confidence and know that we're safe. Bless the Lord this morning as we come together. Give him highest praise right there where you are. Give him all the glory due his wonderful name. As we come together this morning, we are remiss if we do less than praise our God. At this time, let us bow together. Dear God, we come recognizing who you are. Lord God, we surrender to you as Lord of all. Lord, even the coronavirus, your Lord, over it. Lord God, we understand that you sit high and look low, that you superintend all that goes on. Lord God, your word tells us that in you all things hold together. Everything consists in you. And so, Father, help us to surrender ourselves. Help us to focus our minds and yield our bodies to your honor and to your glory. Lord God, as we come together this morning, we pray that if anyone has need, if anyone is struggling, Lord, that they would look to you and that you would provide deliverance. Lord God, we pray if there's anyone that is watching this right now that doesn't know you, Lord, that they would recognize and realize that they need to get on the road to discipleship. Lord God, we pray that your comfort would come alongside and that folks would see the depth of your love for them. Lord God, we lift up the membership of Mount Moriah. We lift up your church around the world. We pray, Lord, that all of us would honor and glorify your name in a way that's pleasing to you. It's in your name we pray. Amen.
Listen, for those of you that are going through, for those of us that are waiting on his promise, understand God has not forgotten you. When times get tough, you got to look up to heaven and encourage yourself and say,
God is able and he cares for you. upon him shall have a new strength. Yeah. They shall mount upon wings
like eagles.
Of eagles that soar.
Go ahead, tell them how you feel.
I'm so glad.
I'm so glad
that I've learned how to wait.
Oh, oh, oh.
In the midst of my waiting, I'm gonna bless him every day.
They shall mount up on wings like an eagle that soars.
They shall
mount up on
wings. They shall
soar.
They shall
mount up on
wings.
Wait on the Lord.
Wait
on the Lord. And he will come through.
Wait on.
About 40 of you say discipleship. You got it.
Amen. We are digging deeper and deeper into the subject of discipleship. Pastor Lassiter taught us the what of discipleship. He taught us what a disciple is. And you remember the answer, right? Just in your home, say it after me. A disciple first follows Christ. Second, builds relationships with those who follow Christ. Third, is transformed by Christ. And fourth, joins Christ on his mission. You remember those. Then later we heard the why of discipleship. We answered the reason why we should do all we can to make disciples. And we learned we should make disciples because, and I'm going to ask you to repeat these with me too, because first, the Great Commission demands it. Second, because people need it. Third, because the church is built by it. And fourth, because we are made Christ-like by it. When we make disciples, we're made Christ-like. Those are four good reasons, amen? But that's not all. So today, we continue with the why. Why make disciples? In addition to what we've already learned, why make disciples? My brothers and sisters, well, it's because, reason number five, because of Jesus' focus. Because of Jesus' focus. Listen, apart from quotes and scriptures, the first line in Rick Warren's pretty famous book, Purpose Driven Life, the first line is, it's not about you. The purpose of your life is far greater than your own personal fulfillment. And so once again, we begin in Matthew 28. And I want to consider another golden nugget of truth gleaned from this greatest of commissions commanded by Jesus. As we imagine this gathering in Galilee, which probably was on a hillside, maybe Jesus' appearance to more than 500 is what's referred to by Paul in 1 Corinthians 15:6. Maybe that's what's going on here. And as we gather and begin to hear Jesus, we're struck. Jesus says, beginning in verse 16, it says in beginning of verse 16, then the 11 disciples went away into Galilee to the mountain which Jesus had appointed for them. When they saw him, they worshipped him, but some doubted. And Jesus came and spoke to them, saying, all authority has been given unto me in heaven and on earth. Go therefore and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things that I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the age. Brothers and sisters, as we watch and listen closely with the 11 disciples and with all the others, our attention is focused on Jesus, and we're struck as we hear him say, go and make disciples of all nations, teaching them to obey everything I've commanded, and I am with you always. We're struck not just because of the command, but also because of his focus. Jesus has all power, right? But his focus is fully fixed on others. I mean, he's concerned about people. He's talking here about all nations. He's saying baptizing them, teaching them. And he says, I'll be with you always. My brothers and sisters, we can't miss Jesus' focus is on other folks. Making disciples is not about me, it's about others. Listen, on the cross, antagonists teased and mocked Jesus. They said, well, he saved others, but he can't save himself. That wasn't true. It's not that he couldn't, it's that he wouldn't save himself because of the nature of his focus, because of the reason he came in the first place. Jesus came to earth with an other's focus. Christ Jesus came into the world to seek and to save the lost. Isn't that right? Mark 10:45, he came to serve and to give his life a ransom for many. That's an others focus, isn't it? John 12:46, he came to bring light into this dark world. John 18:37, he came to bear witness to the truth. In John 6:31, he came to give eternal life. I mean, isn't that an others focus? In Hebrews 2:14-17, he came to be made like us so he could destroy the power of death. He's focused on other folks. In Matthew 5:17, he came to fulfill the law and the prophets. In John 3:16, he came to reveal the Father's love for sinners. And in Mark 2:17, he came to call sinners to repentance. Y'all, I'm just saying, Jesus had an others focus. And we need to have that others focused as well. Jesus' coming was not for himself, but for the benefit of other folks. His coming was at great cost to himself. We know that. He humbled himself and took on the form of a servant, didn't he? He abandoned the fellowship that he had with the Father in glory to take on the sins of the world. We can see it in his calling of the 12. When he called them, he began to teach them to carry on his ministry for the good of other people. We see it in his miracles, healing and meeting needs, as well as by those same miracles, revealing himself to be the Messiah for whom generations have been waiting. We see it in his merciful attitude as he hung on that cross, suffering the shame of hanging on a tree. Remember, he said, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." Brothers and sisters, you and I should be disciple makers. We should make disciples because Jesus' life and purpose is wholly other-centered. It's not self-centered. He gave his all so people could know and grow in him. And he calls we, his disciples, to do the same. Making disciples is not about me. It's not about you. It's about others. And so we must get aligned with Jesus' focus. We'll make disciples then. But then there's a sixth reason, and that's because of God's love. And here I just want you to turn and focus on John 3:16. We all know it. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have eternal life. We know that verse. But in this verse, which reveals all of the greatest, I mean, God so loved, that's the greatest love, amen? That he gave, that's the greatest gift. His only begotten Son, that's the greatest Son. That whosoever, that's the greatest offer. Who believes in him, that's the greatest belief. And shall not perish, that's the greatest escape. And but all shall have everlasting life. That's the greatest life. I mean, this is a passage of greatest, and it's all centered around his love. My brothers and sisters, God is for us. The term world in John 3:16 refers to the people on the earth. He loves us, and because he loves us, he wants us to be united with him in relationship. Jesus willingly, lovingly came to earth to restore that relationship. My brothers and sisters, despite our sin, despite our brokenness and failures, Jesus came to redeem us, to give us life, purpose, to give us mercy and forgiveness, hope, to give us a future. Didn't he come for that? My brothers and sisters, we are greatly loved. Verse 17 in that passage confirms it and restates his love because it assures us God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, that is us, we faulty people, but in order that the world might be saved through him. It's no mistake Part of the definition of disciple making is getting people converted to Christ. God sent Jesus so that no one would perish, but rather have eternal life. So in order for more people to come to know and experience the love of God, you and I need to be disciple makers. We need to be like Paul in 2 Corinthians 5:14. You remember him saying, the love of Christ constrains, it compels us that those who live should not from now on live for themselves, but for him who died and then rose again. He died for us and rose again. My brothers and sisters, we ought to be compelled to make disciples. Why make disciples? Not just because we should, but because grasping his love for us, we want to love and honor him. We want to love and honor him in return, amen? I mean, that's what the scripture says. We love him because he first loved us. The wonder of his love saves us as his disciples. It should be our desire also that no one pass from this life outside of relationship with him. Listen, as Jesus modeled, we should commit to do all we need to do to bring people to a saving, growing knowledge of Christ. My brothers and sisters, that means there may be a family member. That means there may be a neighbor. That means there may be an acquaintance that God would have us begin to build relationship with, that we might bring them along so that they come to Christ. We need to be disciple makers. Well, we can see, amen, that Jesus had a focus. We can see God's love. But there's also God's mission. Coming out of God's love is this mission. And for that, I want you to go back with me to Genesis chapter 3. This is a familiar passage. It's a basic passage that begins the idea of individuals needing to be saved and God's willingness to do that. It says in John 3:15, and I will put, excuse me, in Genesis 3:15, and I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your seed and her seed. The Father's speaking there to the serpent. He says, he shall crush your head, the seed of the woman shall crush the serpent's head, and you shall bruise his heel. Brothers and sisters, Father, this love of the Lord just flows into this mission. The story of the Bible is a redemption story. From the fall, when God confronted the man and cursed the serpent, God has been on a mission. Amen. He's been on a mission to redeem mankind from sin and disobedience. The Old Testament and the Gospels are a story about the family from which the Redeemer, the son of the woman, who will ultimately crush the head of Satan by casting him into the lake of fire. It's a story about that Redeemer coming. And what the followers of that Redeemer did and will do after his resurrection. That's really what the Bible is all about. The heart of God, my brothers and sisters, is to liberate and mature people so people everywhere can be liberated and mature. Amen. It's an ongoing process. God revealed his heart when he chose Abraham in Genesis 12, continuation of the mission. He promises Abraham, all the families of the earth will be blessed through your family. Listen, and that isn't the only time the Lord expresses this desire. God's mission has always been to bless the entire world. He wants to bless all the nations, all the people of the world. My brothers and sisters, we make disciples to engage with God in fulfilling his mission to bless the nations of the earth. Again and again, the scriptures present this mission. Think about Matthew 24:14. There the scripture says, The good news of the kingdom will be proclaimed in all the world as a testimony to all nations. And then the end will come. Mark 16, 15. Go into all the world and preach the gospel to the whole creation. His mission is the whole world, y'all. Luke 24, 46 and 47. Messiah would suffer and rise from the dead the third day, and repentance for forgiveness of sins would be proclaimed in his name to all the nations, beginning at Jerusalem. And you know Acts 1:8, that we would become, we would receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon us, and we would be his witnesses in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and to the ends of the earth, all over the world. Y'all, his mission is to deliver folks everywhere. We need to make disciples because it aligns with God's mission to the world. This little story I want to tell you. In quiet talks, S.D. Gordon, a Christian writer and speaker from Philadelphia in the past century, wrote a series of quiet talks. And in his quiet talks on service, he imagines a scene with Jesus back in heaven after the resurrection. And Jesus talks there with Gabriel. And this is fictional, but it really makes a point. Gabriel comes to the Lord after his resurrection and says, "Lord, how will you make your love, forgiveness, salvation? How will you make your suffering known to the world? How will people know what you've done?" Jesus answered, "Well, I prepared the 11 disciples to make it the business of their lives to tell others, and the others will tell others, and the others will tell others, until the last person in the farthest corner of the earth has heard the story and been impacted by its power." Gabriel thinks for a moment and then asks, "Suppose their descendants, their successors, way off in the 20th or 21st century, get so busy with life, they don't tell others. Then what?" The voice of Jesus comes back very matter-of-factly, "Gabriel, I haven't made any other plans. I'm counting on them." Church, why make disciples? Because Jesus is counting on us to join him in his mission. Finally, we need to make disciples because of Jesus' joy. Because of Jesus' joy. Would you turn with me to John 15? John 15, verse 7. I want to read that in your hearing. Begins this way. Verse 7. "If you abide in me, and my words abide in you, you will ask what you desire, and it shall be done for you. By this my Father is glorified, that you bear much fruit. So you will be my disciples. As the Father loved me, I also have loved you. If you abide in my love. If you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. These things I have spoken to you, that my joy may remain in you, and that your joy may be full." Y'all, there's joy in making disciples. There's joy in making disciples. We can receive the joy of Christ when we make disciples. And somebody says, "How is that? I thought disciple making was suffering and sacrifice." Well, there's some hardship there, yes. But it's much more than just that. Think with me now. Verse 10 teaches, if we keep his commandments, we will be abiding in his love. Verse 9 says, as the Father has loved Jesus, so Jesus loves us. And we need to abide in that love that Jesus has. Then verse 8 says, the Father is glorified when we bear much fruit. Now go back to verse 11, and it says, Jesus has told us all of these things so that his joy could remain with us and so that we can have full joy. But brothers and sisters, Jesus shared all those things to help us understand what it takes to have full joy. We can experience the joy of Christ if we abide in him, which includes keeping his commandments. It's abiding in his love and glorifying the Father, verse 8, by what? By bearing much fruit. Guess what? Bearing much fruit includes making disciples. Why should we be disciple makers? For the personal, right now benefit of the joy of Christ. You know, there are folks who complain and criticize Christianity because it's a far away religion. It's in heaven. That's where the good time comes. My brothers and sisters, there's goodness right now. The joy of Christ can be ours right now. We don't have to wait. We don't have to wait at all. My brothers and sisters, we understand that there is joy right now for everyone who's involved in, among other things, amen, making disciples. Amen. Y'all, there's hardship and opposition in making disciples. But Jesus says in the middle of all that, we can have joy. Not just some joy, but full joy. When I say joy, I mean a state of mind and an orientation of our heart that is a settled state of contentment, confidence, and hope. Don't you want that? Amen. That's available for every believer. But brothers and sisters, Rick Warren, who we mentioned earlier, defines joy as the settled assurance that God is in control. He's in control of all the details of our lives. The quiet confidence that ultimately everything is going to be all right. And the determined choice to praise God in every situation. Do you have that kind of joy? Amen. You sure can. You sure can if you don't. Listen, and it's an awesome, encouraging truth that Christian joy does not only hold in negative situations, but actually it grows stronger through those hardships, trials, and testings. Isn't that what James 1:2 tells us? Count it all joy, right? When you fall into diverse temptations, testings. Why? Because the testing of your faith, amen, works patience. It grows you up. It's a good thing. So joy is a part of the fruit, the product of the Spirit being in our lives, based on Galatians 5, 22 and 23. And it should be a natural, expected, even ever-present attribute of our Christian life. But the Holy Spirit, amen, brings joy. And joy should be, amen, constant in our lives. So part of John's purpose in his writings, chapter 15 and others, is to show Christians how to experience joy and fulfillment as they walk with the Lord. And he shares it often. Just when you get a chance, go back and read 2 John 1:12. John desired to come to them and talk face to face with them so that their joy might be complete, might be full. Here in the Gospel of John, he mentions joy more than 7 times. And in chapter 16, verse 24, he concludes that verse with, ask and you will receive, that your joy may be full. And brothers and sisters, all I'm saying is, this text makes it plain, some of us may not have the joy that should be ours simply because we're not sharing Jesus. We're not making disciples. I'm simply saying, come on, let's get on board. Let's do it. All of us can be disciple makers. He says, I want my joy to remain in you. I want my joy for you to be full. So my brothers and sisters, we've seen another 4 reasons Why to make disciples? We need to be about making disciples because of Jesus' joy, because of God's mission, because of God's love, and Jesus' focus. And when we do, we'll be able to celebrate with those new and growing disciples the sentiment of the songwriter who wrote, "What a wonderful change in my life has been wrought since Jesus came into my heart. Floods of joy o'er my soul, like seagulls roll, since Jesus came into my heart." My brothers and sisters, right now, you can receive Jesus as Lord and Savior. Just confess that you're a sinner. Surrender your heart to Him, and Jesus will receive you as Lord and Savior. He'll receive you as His child. Won't you bow with me? Lord God, we thank you for this moment. We thank you for the depth of your truth and the strength of your word. Lord God, we acknowledge that there's not a person who surrenders to you that you will cast out. Everyone who recognizes their need, recognizes their sinful condition, and confesses Jesus as Savior, Lord, you will come in and make your abode with them. You will become in relationship with them. And so, Lord, we pray, if there's anyone right now who needs relationship with you, that they would receive you, that they would surrender to you right now. And then, Father, we pray for all of us who know you, Lord, that we might reconsider our role in disciple making. How are we doing? What lengths are we going to? Lord God, all of us need to stretch ourselves. Stretch out that we might be disciple makers for your glory. We ask your help in that, knowing, Lord, that you never say no when we're asking that which you want us to do. We give you the glory, Lord, and we thank you in Jesus' name.
Thank you. Before returning to his Father in heaven, Jesus commissioned his followers to go and make disciples. Becoming a disciple begins with a confession of faith in Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. That is step one. Step two is to join a local church such as Mount Moriah and continues with a lifetime of growth in faith and fruitfulness. Call one of our pastors or connection counselors today to join this journey of discipleship. We experience the power of prayer daily at Mount Moriah. Please join us in congregational prayer most days of the week. Also, our pastors post a prayer on our YouTube and Facebook pages each Monday, Wednesday, and Friday mornings. We are also commanded to study God's Word because it teaches us what is true, corrects us when we are wrong, and teaches us to do what is right. Sunday school and Bible study for all ages is available on Sunday and Wednesday, and is open to both members and guests. The continuation of this church's ministry would not be possible without your prayers and your financial support. Thank you so much for your generosity. Remember to view and subscribe to our YouTube and Facebook channels, there as well as on our church website, www.mountmoriahomaha.net. You will find sermons, pastoral prayers, and more information to help you know us and to know the Lord. Finally, we thank you for worshiping with us today and pray that the Lord will bless you and keep you, that the Lord will make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you, that the Lord will turn his face toward you and give you peace. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.